D'accord, madame, messieurs, chers collègues, je vous souhaite la bienvenue à l'Institut historique allemand, au nom de son directeur, Thomas Meissen, pour cette sixième édition de Digital Humanities à l'IHA. À son très grand regret, le directeur ne peut pas être parmi nous ce soir, mais il sera là demain matin pour nous accueillir. Don't worry, this will be the only two sentences I'll speak in French. It's a tradition in this house to open conferences in French, and I didn't want to break this tradition right from the start, as we're probably going to break a lot of traditions tonight and tomorrow during our conference Digital Humanities Experiments. I'm very happy to open this conference and to welcome you here in this beautiful house, the Hotel Julianne. And I would like to address a special welcome to our scholarship holders, 15 young students, who could benefit from travel grants generously allocated by the Standing Committee for the Humanities of the European Science Foundation and the Institut d'Etudes Avancées. Thank you very much to both institutions. Both institutions contribute to make our conference a truly international event with young and a little older scholars coming from Romania, Greece, Finland, Ireland, Austria, Croatia, Italy, Germany, and France, of course. Another special welcome goes to the THET campus. There has been a THET camp in Paris for the last 2 days, and some of the participants come in an Olympic sense and to bring the fire of digital humanities over the Seine to our institute so that it can burn for another 2 days, and burning it will, the fire of digital humanities, so we hope, because we have enough ideas to feed it and to talk and do digital humanities experiments for the next 24 hours. The language of experiments runs throughout the digital humanities, demonstrating its support of risk-taking, entrepreneurship and innovation. As Liza Sparrow puts it, I cite, by leveraging information technology to explore data, digital humanities cast intellectual problems as experiments. What is the effect of modeling the data in a particular way? What happens when we visualize data or use text mining tools to discover patterns? For her, experimentation is a value of digital humanities, next to openness, collaboration, diversity, collegiality, and connectedness. All five values I would like to declare the motto of our conference. Therefore, experimentation not only suggests a method of testing ideas and creating knowledge, but also represents its engagement in transforming traditional approaches of teaching and research. Experiments belong in a constellation of terms such as curiosity, play, exploration, and do it yourself. Not all experiments succeed as originally planned, so the digital humanities community recognizes the value of failure in the pursuit of innovation. During our conference, we will follow up both the metaphorical meaning of experiments and scientific meaning. We want to try something new and be playful, enjoy discussion and science. The format of the conference itself is an experiment, as we want to try new and highly dialogical forms of events. Tomorrow there will be discussions around conversation stations, in short, conversations. We have 3 lounges, giving space and opportunity to retransfer digital practices like Twitter, commenting and blogging into the analog space. And if you feel low and need some food or drinks or electricity, there are the energy stations to upload empty batteries in all ways. But we also want to go beyond the metaphorical sense of experimentations and use scientific experiments in a real hard science way. This is the part that challenges the old humanities the most, as it questions the purely hermeneutical way in which scientific results are generated normally. We will have 4 hands-on data laboratories where the experiments will take place. Experiments as an orderly procedure carried out with the goal of verifying, refuting, or establishing the validity of a hypothesis. Here we are in the heart of the humanities epistemology, challenging traditional ways of doing research in the humanities. The digital humanities could build a bridge over the gap between the quantitative orientation of the natural science and the critical cultural discourses in the humanities. The experiments, however, bring some challenge to the digital humanities too, and there are several questions waiting to be answered. There is a lure of objectivity where the humanities change from interpretative to verifiable knowledge. The interest in computational tools might also indicate a desire to produce knowledge that can compete with the natural sciences on their own terms by being as objective, as rigorous with the help of machines. As we know since several decades, this is not true, and it's important to repeat it. While machines can carry out certain repetitive tasks faster and more precisely than humans can, the adequacy of the questions, models, and assumptions underlying the research are a completely different matter. Or, as the statistician John W. Chipper puts it, far better an approximative answer to the right question, which is often vague, than an exact answer to the wrong question, which can always be vague. For tonight, we'll start with some right questions and hopefully exact answers with a keynote by David, who was kind to help us out when Julianne Nyhan, Plantis, our keynote speaker, couldn't come to Paris. Our commentator, Claudia Mueller-Birn, this morning also informed us that she couldn't be with us tonight. So we asked Julianne Fuchs to take over this responsibility, and fortunately she said yes. So a big merci to both of them, and to me will now present both of them. Thank you very much.
The two protagonists of this evening for me. You see, we're not only thinking about doing experiments in the digital humanities, or what experiments mean in the digital humanities, or the humanities on the whole, but this conference is also doing experiments with us. We lost our keynote, and we lost this morning our discussion, and it was really great that we found so nice and helpful replacements, and at the end, when I look at what we've got, it's a great result. We have somebody from the computer sciences with a big heart for the humanities, David, and somebody coming from the humanities with a big heart for the computer sciences, Milena. So I think this is going to be a really thrilling feature to have both of them speaking to us about this topic, which is in fact a global topic of the changing publication cultures, a topic that Milena has been working on a very, very long time, and David as well, in two quite different perspectives. So I think this is going to be a really nice merge. David Chavarrias has done a master's in mathematics and computer sciences at the École Normale Supérieure de Cachan. Then he was a PhD student at the École Polytechnique in Cognitive Science and Complex Systems with an advisor, Paul Bourgine, and I've met Paul Bourgine at the Institut d'études avancées, and there I saw how important it is that advisors in PhD projects can open horizons, and Paul is such a person who opens questions in the humanities and in the hard sciences. It is at the Institut d'études avancées, where I'm a resident for the moment, that I met David at an event that was quite informal also, a sort of experiment. And since then, we've been in contact, and I thought it would be a nice thing to bring him over to us and to this conference. David Chavarrias is a CNRS permanent researcher at the Centre d'analyse de mathématiques sociales at the École d'études en sciences sociales, the HESS, and he is the director of the Complex Systems Institute of Paris-Île-de-France. His research interests are web mining and quantitative epistemology, cognitive economics, and modeling of cultural dynamics, as well as collective discovery and scientific discovery. And rendering these discoveries in publication forms also engenders a new view of what is the social part behind science. Milena Tisch-Fuchs is a linguist, a cognitive linguist. I think you both have another bridge between your biographies. And she's a full member of the Croatian Academy of Sciences and Arts. And just for the little story, she also was once the Croatian Minister of Science and Technology. Milena graduated from the University of Zagreb's Faculty of Humanities and Social Sciences. She majored in English language and literature and ethnology. She received an MA in linguistics and a PhD also in linguistics. Since 2002, she holds the position of Chair of Linguistics at the Department of English in Zagreb. Milena is a full member of the Croatian Academy of Sciences and Arts, and she was elected member of the Academia Europea in 2013. She was the chair of the Standing Committee for the Humanities at the European Science Foundation, which is winding up, and there now she chairs the Science Review Group of the European Science Foundation. Thank you, both of us, of you, for coming to and speaking to us this evening, and we are really thrilled and are waiting for your inputs. Thank you.
Well, you know,
that would be great
to the game, as they say. No, but joking aside, David, I think that you should simply start from everything Claudine said. I think we should get married eventually. joke, don't worry. But I'm really interested in this topic because, apart from everything else, I have been doing quite a lot of work in changing publication cultures, and I won't even mention how many years I've been doing the metrics. And for the people who were here 2 years ago, I had a keynote on bibliometrics and changing arena. So I'm more than interested in what you have to say. David, please.
Thank you. So thank you for this nice introduction, and thank you to Marek and Claudia for this invitation. Very happy to present this work now. Just to present quickly my research and how I conducted them, what I will present to you mainly in this talk, which is the modeling of quantitative discovery process. And then I have some results that I will show you, and they have been updated recently. And after getting this result, I feel the need to go to see how science evolved in vivo, how the biologist says in vivo. So looking at scientific publication and try to see if we can extract or mine the patterns of science dynamics directly from the publication. And this leads to a second strand of research that I started a little more than 10 years ago, which is towards science metrics and reconstruction of science dynamics. So I will start speaking with that, but very shortly. The book is not on mining science dynamics directly from the science metrics. We can talk about this later. But I will start with this to go after to my first love, which is I will try to keep it understandable. I don't really know what are the level of audience in terms of modeling, so I will keep this quite generic and general. And please don't hesitate to interrupt me if there is something that I'm not clear. So, if we look about our digital environment today, we can notice that we have various sources of media and textual contents, which each one having its own time scales. So you have scientific publications, for example, which are published every month, every year. You have the news, which are published in the press every day. Blogs, where you can have posts every hour. Tweets, people who tweet every minute, and queries. And one question is, what can we say about cultural dynamics if we mine all these contents through time? Can we identify some trends, and can we tell some things that can bring up some results that could be confronted to other results in the European social science or results in informatics? Now I will mostly speak about the mining of science, but methods that we have developed such that they could mine unstructured textual data. So the idea is really to be able to do the same process of reconstruction that I will present just now over all these different corpora and see, according to the different arena, what are the dynamics. So if we focus on science, so if you look at dynamics, the zero level of analysis is, for example, what Google does, Google Trends. When you pick up the terms and you look at how many times it is mentioned in the web, or how many times it is mentioned in digital archives. So, for example, here you have Easter, you see that it is quite regular every year at Easter. You have earthquake, which are strongly irregular with different strength, which we can guess is proportional to the strength of the earthquake itself, and you have big earthquakes and a lot of media was talking about that, etc. And you have isolated events like Fukushima, which made something maybe even start with. So this is only the zero of the dynamics of dynamics. You can do the same things in science if you go to your favorite research engine. So this is something that we develop at the Institute, but it's also quite standard in most providers. You can search for terms, for example, scientometrics, look at the evolution of communication and see, okay. And now it's a field that is strongly developing since here, 2006, if we look here, like this screen. But now, if you want to go to a higher level, and here I just show the picture, I don't want to enter into the detail, but one question was, can we visualize the dynamic of science? And we all have the feeling that science is divided into disciplines and sub-disciplines. When we go to an archive, we are told to put our papers in physics and condensed matter, etc., or sociology, etc. So we all think about science as being structured into different disciplines. We can talk to each other. And the question was, can we see the evolution of disciplines and formation of disciplines and sub-disciplines through the mining of scientific literature? So this is one of our answers. This is an answer made in the framework of cohort analysis for those who know these topics, which is you are making some text mining on publication, you are extracting some relevant expressions that synthesize the domain that you are studying. So you can have a vocabulary of 2,000 expressions for biology or for sociology or for cognitive economics, etc. And from this expression, you are trying to summarize every period of time, for example, every year, which are the topic. Here, a topic will be given as a set of keywords. A little like when you go to a conference registration and they say we accept paper on this and this and this topic, so it's generally a set of keywords. And this is the level of granularity that we want to reach. And the question was, can you just take all the publication in, for example, the cognitive economics through years, make some text mining analysis, do some graph and complex network analysis to identify bags of words that will define topics, and look how these topics will evolve. This is the result. When you look at that, I won't go into detail, just to make the feeling of that. I have some publication about this. But the result is that each square here is a topic. So if you had the interactive visualization, you can go inside and see what is it about. So it could be digital humanities and experiment and step to matrix, something like that. So each square is the time flows from top to bottom. So here is 1990, and here is 2010, or something like that. And when we do this identification of topics through times, we're able to say these topics generated from that topics and draw a line between the two, which are the only vertical lines we have to see here. And at the end, when you do that, you see some shapes that are presented by to you by the software that we have built, which we call phylogeny, which is a biology of phylogeny in biology, which show you how the different topics in the domain that you are looking at are evolving. So, for example, this is a study that we have done with the German Humanities about bias in biomedical literature. So we have mine PubMed, which is the main biomedical archive. We looked to all the abstract and titles that mention some kind of bias that we have identified. We have also identified the context of this bias, like for example, cancer research, breast cancer, tobacco, something like that. So we should have our terms that contextualize this bias, and we apply this method of clustering terms, making a topic identification, and looking at the evolution of topics, and we have this kind of shapes. So this shape, for example, this branch here, which is getting more bushy at the end, is a branch of meta-analysis. Meta-analysis is a full branch of biomedicine, which is people that are trying to take previous results, aggregate them and test them. These are building larger cohorts of people and see if the results proposed in the papers still hold. And it's also a branch that have given some strong evidence of a lot of kind of bias, for example, publication bias, translation bias in the publication and scientific metrics. So here you see the branch of meta-analysis, which is getting larger and developing. And if you zoom in, you will see the different terms. And here you have another term, which is, I think, about cardiovascular diseases and other branches. So these are reconstruction, and this poses a lot of questions about the accuracy of that, how you interpret these kind of things, what are the social networks behind that, can you find regularity inside this kind of structure. I will not talk about that, but the general idea is that now we are really in a stage with a large digitalization of science production where we can have approaches of science evolution which stems from epistemology, scientometrics, and computational social science that are becoming common forever. If you look at this kind of structure here, then you see in, for example, epistemology or science history, you have a lot of hypotheses about how science evolved, how new fields emerge. Can we confront this theory and hypothesis to what we observe in through bibliometric analysis with this dynamic of reconstruction? On the other hand, as I will show, there is a lot of work about making models about how scientists publish, how they cite each other, and these models are making some predictions about what are the effects of some kind of settings of science and science policy on the development of science. And now that we have this kind of empirically extracted evolution, we can also think about, can this extracted evolution be compared to model prediction? So actually what we have here when we look at that, we don't need to look at that, we think in these terms, is that science is a collective discovery process, which is a process where a knowledge body, which is here a set of topics which are developing, is elaborated by several people in a distributed and asynchronous way. So people are in different labs, they are making some private research, this private project occasionally become public through publication, and all this is combined to make science evolve. And so the question will be, what can we say about science now in terms of the modeling approach? as being a collectively discovered process. So I will take just one example, because when I talk about science, we have different disciplines which rely differently on experiment on our theoretical tools. So we have a full spectrum of kind of science. And what I will talk about now does apply directly to some kind of science and not to others. So this could be also a discussion of papers and how we can address it. But if I take an example, for example, in biology, if you take, for example, the people that work about yeast biology, so they are studying yeast and all the genetic property of yeast, there has been an interesting paper in 2009 that has looked about, because in PubMed, and the biologists, when they discover a property about, for example, with yeast genome, for example, genetic interaction or gene-protein interaction, they publish a paper, but they also publish in a standard way saying that this gene interacts with this gene or this gene interacts with this protein. So we have the whole history of discovery of this yeast genetic networks, and we can mine it to see how it has been discovered. After a while now, we have discovered about everything about that network, so we can go back in time and say, knowing the structure now that we know it, how the science has done to discover it. So this is a very interesting paper, which we are looking about that. So just to have things in mind, gene interaction are separated in two types, genetic interaction and protein gene interaction. So two genes are said to interact genetically if the effect of one gene on a trait is masked or enhanced by the other, so we can test it with an experiment. And two genes are said to have a PPI, so protein-protein interaction, if their protein products physically bind to each other stably or transiently. So you have clear properties that you can test, and people have discovered all these properties. So they did some text mining about this literature, and this is the conclusion. So they see that important subjects in terms of fitness impact. So you can measure the fitness impact of a gene-gene interaction. For example, if you eat this interaction, you can measure the impact on the organism, if the organism is still alive or not. So important subjects tend to be studied earlier. But before you study it, you don't know. That's not important. The growth of knowledge is heterogeneous and episodic. So this is really compared with some theory in science. History of science. Familiar subjects are preferentially studied over new subjects, leading to a reduced pace of innovation, so you have path dependency in the discovery. And one thing interesting is that what they found is the number of discoveries per researcher is greater in smaller teams. So the question is, can we make some model of that, and or what are the mechanisms behind this? So I will take this example because I think that in terms of discovering some properties, it will be a blueprint through my talk, although there is no scientific activity that are not covered by this example. So now the question is, what can we say about science dynamics in visualizing a collective discovery process? So if we have in mind community discovery in the yeast network, how can we model it? So here I will propose a model that have been proposed. I have proposed it in 1998, so it was like more than 10 years before this article. So it's not correct, but when this article went out, I thought that it was a really nice introduction to what I will present now. So this is our main problem in science, is that it's impossible to prove any hypothesis absolutely true. There is always a possibility that new data are contrary to your theory. So actually, this is Karl Popper's epistemology and other epistemology theories. So I like this sentence, we don't know, we can only conjecture, which is very synthetic and clear. And this is one of sentence from Bruckner's book, Conjecture and Ratification. I say, a scientist, let him be a theorist or an experimentalist, proposes some statements and tests them step by step. So I read this book when I was doing my master thesis, when I present now, it's coming from this research. And when I read this book, I was coming from the modeling part of that, by doing mathematics and computer science. My question was, can we make a model about that? And what would this model predict in terms of collective dynamics? So I will now present you this model. So step by step, imagine that you have Einstein relativity theory. Then you can set up some experiments, test them, and the experiment is true or false. And if it's true, you say, okay, this theory has been corroborated, let's go ahead, and maybe you will more confidently rely on that theory to do all the things. For example, and this is interesting because, for example, precisely on Einstein theory, there is an example where, for example, there is this famous example of experiment where you separate two photons that are interact at some point, and you separate them, and when the quantum theory predicts that if you measure one of them, instantly you will change the state of the other photon, even if they are very far away, and with a speed which is more higher than the light speed. So when this experiment was proposed as mind experiments, Einstein said, this is not impossible because nothing can go more quicker than the light. It's not possible to have a transfer of information quicker than light. So it's even not useful to do this experiment because the answer would be no. In the 1980s, a very famous physicist said, okay, I'm convinced that we have to do this experiment. He did this experiment, and the answer was that Einstein was wrong. And this is one of the first refutation of Einstein's theory. So this experiment was possible because at that time we have this new technology, but also it was possible before, but people have not attempted this because it was like one that has to fail. So you test and eventually you produce some refutation. So when you are testing a theory, you have a direct problem of exploration and exploitation trade-off for dilemma. I think the more exact term is dilemma in English. So how long you test your theory before you publish it and before you use the theory in further theory and experiments? So if you highlight popular theory, not all popular theory, but just a few samples that I mentioned, we can model the activity of scientific discovery with a project card where somebody tests his idea and hypothesis against nature or against colleague, if it's not experimental science. And he has some feedback that it is corroborated or no. So here, for example, the theory, which is an imaginary theory of these squares of missing data, have been corroborated 7 times and falsified 1 time. But the thing is that imagine that you don't have this counterexample here, you only have positive results, you never know if your theory is still true, because for example, Newton's theory was for a long time so never falsified, actually, okay? Show that in very particular settings it can be falsified, and this was the same theory. And so how long you test your theory before you think that it is good and before you publish? And yes, there is a public part where the theory is on the public place, so it is has been published, and anybody can try to falsify it, come back and try to make other tests and improve its scores. So when you are a scientist, you are faced with very schematically. Now we are modeling, so we are really making things much more simpler than they are in reality. So we are faced with two options. Either you go here, trying to explore things that nobody has proposed, and generally when you have a good idea, you look, you Google your favorite search, and you say, oh, it has somebody already talked about this and this, and how it can be related. If no, you say, okay, you are even more excited and try to work on that. Or you can also take the publication of someone and try to falsify for say, 1 week to produce an experiment. If it's after 1 week, it's still okay, you say, okay, I can rely on that. And maybe you eventually you falsify. And when you have done, you come back and you choose. Of course, we have several of these processes in parallel. So first, in the model that we will talk about, we'll have dichotomy that people or agents first choose one action, either to explore new things or to try to falsify somebody else. In every of these processes, you will say, okay, I will give you 1 week, 1 month, 1 year to work on that. And if after 1 week, 1 month, 1 year it is satisfying, and will eventually publish it or try to falsify it, and you go for publication. The real question is that you never have a red flag saying that now your theory is true, especially in experimental science, for example, in biology. You have to rely, because you rely on the current technological facilities, the measurements that you have at your period, so you never know if later other data or other more sophisticated protocol will falsify. So you have to choose when to stop. And also you are evolving in a dynamical environment. For example, in the yeast networks, if you are specialized in the yeast networks, at some moments, all the yeast network has been discovered, so you can do some other things about yeast, but at one moment, this topic is so, now ask you the question, what kind of scientist you are? And try to think about it, because it will be useful after to have some empathy with the model. So, how much time you check your journal before publication? I know very different people. Some like say just rush to publish. Others they never publish. Are just happy to have been working 3 years on that and know well the topic, and they never go. Others are in between. So I'm just shutting down my phone. So this is in this model it could be a parameter lambda, which is how much time you wait before you say, okay, now I have only positive results, I can go for publication. How much time you spend checking or trying to falsify the result of theory of your work relies on, or other theory. If you will go to contradict somebody about actor network theory, for example, good hypothesis, or say, okay, there is another theory, or I don't know, say this gene-gene interaction is not right. There is some fault in the settings. I'm reducing they are wrong. So how much time you do that? How long you take it when you go to that process? And also, how often you try to test other theory? Because one thing is to test other theory, and the other thing is how long you try to contradict something. And has a Chinese saying, publish at Christmas, repeat at Easter. So we all have this in mind that when you publish, all the community will look at what you have done, and you have to anticipate this. So we'll model publication strategy by these three parameters, which is propensity for go for our publication, which is new, and lambda cream, which are in mathematical probabilistic theory, it is called stopping time. So you are saying, okay, I will go for a process for at least 20 steps, except if before these 20 steps I'm stopped by, for example, a counterexample. Now we have the social game of science. If you start here, you say, because this here is defined by difference. First, your personality, and besides all the consideration, prestige, salary, etc., how you like science, but also pressure from your university to publish or your laboratory to publish, pressure from the other things that, okay, if I don't publish now, other people will publish the same thing before, so all my time will be wasted or will not be recognized. So there is various ways that impact on this kind of strategy. And if we think of it, imagine an artificial society of scientists. You have some interesting negative feedback, which is when scholars are serious, verification is hard, so it becomes easier to conjecture than to refute. So if you believe that your colleague is very serious and that he has really well done his experiment, then it will not take time to try to check that. Have the result and build on it. But if too few scholars refute others' work, one can be less serious without being detected. And if this is disseminated in the population, then if too many people are not serious, then it becomes easier to falsify that to conjecture, because you are in a domain where there's only bullshit, and it's easier to say, okay, you are wrong because of that, you are wrong because of this, etc. But now, if most of them become too falsified, it's better to become serious in front of you, you know, in front of you, all the committee waiting for you, and you come back here. So all these different steps are actually merged in one, so you have all these dynamics at the same time. But it reflects exactly what you can think when you are thinking about your own activity, how your work will be accepted by the community, how it will be checked, etc. So now, what influences this strategy? Here we go more further in the modeling, and we will go in the framework of game theory, where you say game theory, we have agents that are more or less rational, and they have some payoff associated to action, and they try to find the action that leads to higher payoff. So here's payoff could be money or salary, but it could be also prestige, reputation, something like that. And we look at three parameters to be simple, and we can discuss about that. First is reward for publication. For example, there is some university saying that if you don't publish at least on average 2 papers per year, then you might lose your position. Second is reward for reputation. This is very interesting because in some domains it is really acknowledged that reputation is important. In some other domains, it is not so well acknowledged. If you show that somebody is wrong, then okay. It's not always the results or not always the publication. And also what you lose from being falsified. We have a lot of scandals about people classify their own data. When they have discovered, they lose all their careers and jobs. It's a high. They lose a lot of things, but in some domains, it is accepted to make some errors. It's not so important. So there are different degrees according to the community. So now, one question, for example, is what is the impact of the publish of courage policy on science, engineering, and dynamics? So in this framework, publish our courage policy will be translated into very high reward for publication compared to reward for refutation or no starting refuting. If you say, if you don't publish 2 papers per year, or you publish your 2 papers per year, or you lose your position, then you have a very high incentive to publish whatever it is. Influenced by the age of the field, because, for example, if you look at big data fields now, it's like expanding really rapidly, lots of data, a lot of paper, doing some data mining, everything. And so it's expanding very quickly, But after some time, then maybe most of the interesting way to explore data will have been explored. So the landscape will shrink. Or if you think about this yeast genetic interaction networks, and after a while there is no more interaction, so you have to change it from different animal or so you have to. So is it better to be pioneer or mainstream? This could also be a question. There are somebody that systematically, when there is news, something new, they switch and they go to that domain. And others that are staying in their domain for a very long time, so are really well recognized experience. So now we're going which is another games, which has been studied in a different way. Analytic modeling, multi-agent modeling, also online experiments, and now also trying to do some data mining. So imagine you have a community of N players, so there are scientists, and you have a set of theory. Here is a really strong hypothesis for your model. Think about the yeast genetic interaction, interaction with the yeast genetic networks. So if you know the number of genes, you have at most the square number of interaction plus their intensity, but so you are in finite space. In other disciplines, you are in open space, which is great. But here we'll take the simplest model for theory. Here the theory will just be barely viable. Barely viable is probabilistic model, where you can instantiate this variable, and every time you draw this variable, it gives you 0 or 1. And the probability to have a 0, the probability to have a 1 is its parameter. And for example, if you take a coin, if you flip it, normally you should have half and half, so the parameter is 0.5. But you can have bias coin, where the parameter is 0.7 or 0.3. And we'll consider this as a minimal theory, saying that agents have to find a theory that always gives a one. And we have agents that have P for publication, R for refutation, and use L when they are different. But the question is, how the dynamics, how we have a collective dynamics if agents are playing these games and trying to be the winner of something that they play for example for 100 steps or 2 years, and at the end we count the points, the number of P, the number of R, and we subtracted the number of L for every agent, and so the agent with the highest score has a number. So you can model it in terms of game theory, where you have strategic agents. So here you can make an equation and say, okay, agents are infinitely rational. They optimize over all their life, and you define some strategy, and you find some natural equilibria, and you say, okay. Like, given the parameter R, P, and L, and also the distribution of my theory in terms of difficulty between 0 to 1, I can have, for example, 10% of true theory, and the other is only half chance to have a true result. So, according to this parameter, you can approach. But this makes some very strong assumption, like agents are infinitely rational. So, this bias actually. So after I went to something more closer to reality, which is between reality and between analytical description, which is a multi-agent approach. In multi-agents, what you do is that you define agents in silico, so informal agents that have a set of actions. So here the action are, I choose a theory, I test a theory after sometimes steps, I decide to publish or not. I pick a theory from somebody else, there's some transcript, and it's actually short. And we are looking at how this dynamics evolve, knowing that agents have some scores. So every time steps, we look who has published, and we give some payoff to the result who has published, who has been refuted, and we remove some payoff from those agents. Then also agents are adaptive, they observe each other, and if there are some colleagues that are making better than themselves, and they will say, okay, what is his strategy? He's publishing a lot. Okay, maybe I will try to publish more. He is, on the contrary, trying to falsify another. Okay, I will try to falsify another. So they are that team in this dynamic environment. So you can try the simulations online as well. So these are the results from simulations. This is a question that you can ask about this kind of problem. Here you have surface plot, where here you have a time. So you start with all your agents. They begin with a set of theories that they don't know what you have inside. They pick up theories and test them. They publish. They being transferred from each other. And after a moment, there's no more theory. Everything has been published. Every bad theory has been trashed, so declared to be false theory. And every good theory is in the collective basket. So you say the discovery process is ended. As ended. And so you can look at, according to the publication payoff, so here one means that what you win when you publish is exactly what you lose when you are falsified. So if you publish and you are falsified, you don't. When the publication payoff is increased, so you increase incentive, three, it means that if you publish one paper, then it's you. If you are falsified, if you only lose one third of what you get, so for example, you don't lose your job, you just have a little less resources that you can lose on, etc. And on the contrary, if the publication payoff is here is less than one, so it's the ratio between what you lose and what you gain, being publishing and being falsified, it means that here it's in one third, it means that if you publish three papers and one is falsified, then you lose everything. You have to publish so. You see that this will say what is the incentive for publication. So what, and the mean quality here, this mean quality is because we are working with barely viable, so we are in the set of basket where you have all the published theory, you have, for example, 10 theories that have been published and accepted by the community for now, because you are not only know what are the parameters of this theory, so you know what are these quality and what is the probability that if you pick up one of these theory, you have a failure or you have a counterexample. So this probability could be 1 of 10, 1 of 10 minus 2, 1 of 10 minus 8. So here you have the exponent. When you are here, it means that the probability that the one random theory fail when you test it in the set of public theory is 1/10^8. If you are here, the quality is very low because you have almost one chance or two to find a counterexample if you test the theory. So, for example, if you think about an industry which is building some plane, so you have some norms saying that the plane should have a security of more than 1/10^6 or 10^8. I think that for a nuclear plant is 1/10^7, for example. One major action. Yes. So if you are building planes, you will adapt some strategy so that what is going out is sufficiently reliable. So what you see here is that this is time. So 3 times the quality of what is published is increasing because you are publishing things, but others are curating what you are publishing, etc. But what you see here is that when the incentive for publication is low, or if refutation is well recognized, then you go very quickly to high quality and you stay there. Whereas when your publication payoff is high, so you have high incentive for publishing, then the mean quality is very low. So here, in terms of every week, one of over 10 minus 2 or 10 minus 3 chance to have a convergent compute test. So this is the first observation that you can do. I won't enter into the details of the simulation, but this is just to give you a favor, is that you can explore how increasing the incentive for publication, what's the impact in terms of collective dynamics and quality of what is published. And here you have a clear impact. You have also impact on the research time. For example, here you have, sorry, the axes are not the same way. So here you have publication payoff and here you have time. So you see that when publication payoff increase, the time that each agent in this artificial society spend for searching a theory before I go to publication is going down. And this is the main reason why the quality is going down, because you rush for publication and that cannot be good for. So I will not show you all the results, but the standard science fact from this analysis is that bigger covers slower and publish less if you normalize by people per month than a smaller community. But they have highest mean quality for the second community theory. So this is really close to what the people from the paper on the GD interaction said when they say that smaller team have a higher rate of. The second sense fact is that there is trade-off between the speed of the discovery and the quality of the published theory. If you measure the speed of the discovery here, actually there is another graph that I won't show here, but you see that when if you increase the payoff for publication, people are published more. So you go more quickly to the end where everything has been curated and everything is clean. But during all this process, the quality is lower. So if you are bold with pain, this is not a good strategy. But if you want to use pain while you are doing this research and development, you can crash. But if you are doing something else, maybe you can. So an increase. So there is a trade-off between the speed and the quality of the story. The third fact is that an increase in the incentive for publication leads to a decrease in the mean quality of a set of accepted theories. So this is exactly what I have just commented. And the fourth fact is that when you have limited dynamics, first, the strategies are very heterogeneous, so contrary to a naive model where you say, take the average agent, the representative agent, and say everybody is doing the same. So you have a very heterogeneous population. But moreover, for a given parameter, but if you have a given policy setting with your different parameter, then you can have different dynamics. So you have a strong path dependency, and what we see are the trends set, which is average over different times. So you can have a local, with exactly the same situation, you can have local norms evolving towards being more or less used. So now I am almost done with this presentation. So I see this kind of in silico and modeling like a laboratory to explore some questions in silico, like for example, impact of public policy, what is the impact of raising the incentive for publication? And after you make some prediction, and after what is interesting is that you go to the publication and do some publication mining to see what you can do. So if you can corroborate this kind of observation prediction, which is exactly what I did with this paper, and this is also what I do when I do some reconstruction analysis. We can look at the influence of the hardness of the fields over the dynamics. We know that fields are more technical than others. There is a higher entry cost for some fields, so we can try to experiment what could be the influence of that. Also influence of the size of the community in dynamics, and every time we can really produce some predictions that can be tested against analysis of the bibliography. Also, interaction of topology. Is it better to have a lot of small lab that interact only once a year through large conference, or be really interconnected? What is the impact of that? Except for a lot of things. also we can see that not only to be limited to science discovery, but there is a lot of collective discovery process in science, but also in the media. For example, Wikipedia is also a collective discovery process. People are contributing each other, correcting, things like that, checking. You have also all the community of open source software. Here you have platforms which are specially built to propose your code and to be debugged by other people, which is more or less information. And what is interesting is here is that in the open source, here reputation has another connotation, another, because if I propose a software and somebody comes and say you have an error in your code, you have to fix this, I'm grateful for you. And for me, it's very nice. I'm not saying, okay, it's too bad that I was wrong. He's really helping me. So you have different ways to articulate publication, refutation, and rules for being refuted in different collective discovery processes. One question is, can we go beyond this quality and speed trade-off? For example, if you play with rewarding to refutation, I also think that you can gain more by refutating somebody that being refuted. This will change something. So let me explain sharing errors. There is idea about what about making some negative result journals, because there has been some attempt for that. So what the impact of that? And also identify some potential side effects of some policy. But yet, it's only simulation. Okay, so there is a huge gap here and what we can see in real life. So first step is you go, you go to text mining, or you go to sociological survey. And the other steps is that you go to implement this game, but real role player in terms of like experimental units. So this is what we did. We made the first attempt in 2005, which was not so successful because it was too complicated implementation. But last year we did with Jean-Baptiste, which is here, and Basia Panay, another test where we exactly implement this community of researchers that has to test Benjamin Barrel and can fortify each other and get some payoffs, do some things. And at the end of the play, which could be 3 minutes long or 1 day long, the winner has a model. And now this is one thing that we are studying through this game. So I invite you after the talk, for those who want that, to play together to that game, so that you can feel what is it to be a scientist and to be a falsifier. And we can try all the science policies to see if we have some propositions that we make all people more happy. And so I think for attention, I think it's really worth a demo, but I think we should have a discussion and maybe have to go for this demo. Thank you. You don't need to install anything for that. You just go with your browser, smartphone, and type it on the screen.
Okay, we will play afterwards. Joking aside, I found this very impressive. But before I ask my questions, because I'm going to have to work, okay? And the actual model was based on PubMed and Web of Science. In other words, the complete data that you use, these are the two main sources. This is what I'm trying to get at.
For this kind of.
This was Web of Science, right?
So this is PubMed.
Yeah.
PubMed, Web of Science, but we can make this. We use some of these blogs. The same with blogs. I can show you some examples where we use some internet. This is. I can show you
later. See a blog.
I will show you. I can show you a blog. Because it's not my computer. It's not my advice.
Well, okay, but you mentioned PubMed a number of times, and you had the biomedical stuff, etc., etc.
I will show you.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah, but I have to switch on my social media.
My question is, and then I'll get something that I found very interesting, and it's not just a question to you, it's to everybody, because most people here, I'm assuming, are from the humanities, right? Is my assumption right? Yes, we are mostly here from the humanities. Some of these, there are two points that I would like to bring up while you're digging this up. The slide we had on rewards for publications, this was towards the end, rewards for a reputation and loss for being refuted. This was one of the three things that you had on the slide towards the end. My question is, you know, I was thinking, does this apply in the same way and in, to the same extent in the humanities? But I would like to go also back to your example in physics. Mm-hmm. The fact that Einstein came up with his theory of relativity does not annihilate Newton physics in many ways. Yeah. Neither does the stuff that came after Einstein annihilate this. It's a kind of building of knowledge. And I'm getting to the main question. What does it then mean for a theory to be refuted in this model? I mean, how do you balance out the continuation?
So,
you know,
yeah.
I mean, Newtonian physics is still valid, just like Einstein's theory.
Yeah, yeah,
so what is the true meaning of being refuted then in this sense that you're trying to do here?
So here is the...
Are we doing something wrong?
No, you just need to use the Wi-Fi is called event. You try to log in onto the
one. So
this is my first question, yeah, or a comment.
So here, this model, which is another one, really start with the simplest assumption of what could be a theory and what could be the motivation for a researcher. Of course, it's a theory could be much larger. And for example, we have thought about trying to make models of more sophisticated so that you can improve your theory or something like that. But for me, this is an important way of going. But before going this way, because after we can, it's quite infinite. How far you can go to model what is a theory, what is a cognitive agent, etc. So you can try to improve your model. But here, really, what is interesting me is what is the effect of the collective interaction over something that has these properties to be able to make some prediction and to be falsified on those predictions. Even if sometimes, for example, if you are falsifying on a theory, then let's say, okay, you lose something and your theory is dead. But you can imagine that you refine it and correct it and try to say, okay, if you look for measurements that are higher than 1 centimeter and below, then this is another theory. So you can always refine. And in this model, it would be a model that has the fact that a set of theory is dependent on your technology and the means you have to test it. And you can have some evolution in the technology that can show that in some circumstances your theory is wrong, and then you can expand your theory in that way. And you can also imagine, so for example, here in all what I show is there is only one RNA, it's like a closed space of theory, which is very limited. But one question is, what happens when you have several spaces? And if agent can move from one space to the other, if you have opportunistic agents that say, okay, we have higher payoff when the field is starting, then you have a like, migration of agents. So you have lots of phenomena that you can start to study with this kind of model.
So this is the kind of basis from which you then go on to the other stuff. Am I getting it right?
Yeah, yeah. This is the. But This could be has more sophistication, of course, like every model. There's already been. Also, there is other models. Here, what is really interesting, I think, is the nonlinear effect between individual trade-off in exploration and exploitation, and how is this translate to collective trade-off and impact.
You know, I was fascinated by some things, but this is the area where I think we, and I'm talking about the humanities in general, which is maybe not a good idea, because disciplines within the humanities, of course, will differ, even if you were to apply a model like this, I think we'd come up with differences. So, but I was fascinated by a number of things. I am worried about this, let's call it, knowledge continuation, but publish or perish has had an unbelievable influence on the humanities as well now. Maybe you haven't modeled it, but it's a known fact. And I liked these, I'm not sure about what, but we get rewards for publishing, right? That's the way of the world at the moment. And you do have to publish a certain number of papers in the humanities. I stress this depending on where you live and at which university or whatever you teach. Now, the one that I found absolutely fascinating was rewards for reputation. Is this something, I'm asking my colleagues, is this something that really is sort of felt in our disciplines? I leave that as an open question. I don't know the answer, frankly. The loss of being reputed, that's the third point on that slide you had. I'm not sure if you are really and truly refuted in the humanities about a theory not being a linguist. I'll come up with very simple examples that everybody knows. I think it's more or less an accepted fact today that the generative paradigm, or rather what Chomsky came up with, does not work.
That would have been my input to you.
Yeah, I mean, but I don't think he's had a loss of reputation for it. So what I'm trying to say that the value systems, you see, you know what I'm, you know, trying to get at. I'd love to apply, if possible, this model, but to, let's say, history or linguistics or adequate one, doesn't matter what, and see how it functions where these, let's call them philosophical ideas behind the model, are fundamentally different. This is the point that I would like to bring up. This is my main, but I have lots of other things, but we'll discuss it later. This is, you know, it's the philosophy of the approach of the hard sciences, whether it's biomedicine, physics, etc., which in many ways are different from what we do. So, my question, if you like, is can we change the philosophical categories for, let's say, the humanities and produce a slightly adapted model or something like that?
Absolutely. And even about reputation. In some domain, in some circumstances, for being falsified or being refuted is not a loss but a payoff, because you are put in the place, and this theory is important because this guy is very important, takes some time to speak about it and think that this is bad. So you can look at the effect when instead of course you have a reward and seeing what are the effects of that. And I think that.
And just one, and then I'll give the floor to people, don't worry, is that something that I found absolutely two little bits, that it's better to be a pioneer than to be mainstream. This is one of the things that came up.
This is for a question.
So it was a question.
We can. According to the settings that we choose, is in this setting, is it better to become your...
Again, if we transfer this to the humanities, this is terribly interesting. I don't know the answers, of course. Somebody would have to sit down and work it out. Sometimes it's good to be a pioneer, but if you're a young person building your career at a university and you have to publish, I don't know how many papers, then up to a certain extent, you have to be mainstream. And the other little itsy-nitsy bit that is the, and came up at the end, again, wait a minute, where is it?
Right, it's the fact that if you work in the slide you have on the smaller number of researchers, the smaller labs at the very end somewhere, if you could just go through them. If you work in big groups, it's less effective. This was the general.
It's when you, if in person per month.
Yeah.
Of course, if you are more, you faster. But if you normalize by person per month, you have less discovery.
Again, if I may, if this is it, yeah. I would love to see this model with a slightly different philosophical basis applied to humanities disciplines. Because we work individually most often and write our papers, you know, it's a completely different ballgame. I try to, since this is a human, you know, I try to extend your model and try to think of the basic, let's say, postures in connection with what people in this room do in their normal lives. So this is just a sort of introduction, and if I may call it a bridge towards the humanities, but I open the floor for questions for David, comments.
So do you want
I
take 5 minutes?
Sure. Look, I looked at the program. It starts at 6, but there's no end.
There's no end. So let's take 1 hour. No, I will, very quick, but this is important because the technique has been applied to blocks, so it's a phenomenal reconstruction applied to blocks. This is the work I did with Camille Roth and Jean-Philippe Pointet, which we were in PhD in the same lab. We work on these topics since then. So here we work on, there was a question about, we work on with the Ministry of Research in France in 2010. And so they have large domain, like science and health and environment, energy, etc. And for every domain, they're doing some monitoring of news, etc. And they had a question. The question was, can we apply your approach to blogs? Or it's blogs and all dynamical contents of the internet. So for example, the newspapers or CNRS news, something like that. And what can we say about that? So this is a result about over 6 months of blogs from August to so August 2009 to December 2009. So January 2010. So what we did is that. First, we choose some, we turn toward a company which is specialized into extracting blog content. So this company has like 10 or 15,000 blogs, very active in Francophone blog. This is what's a French blog. So very active that they absorb all the content daily and they use this for do some studies. So we go towards them, we ask them to give us the raw data over the 6 months, and from this raw data we identify a little more than 2,000 blogs and websites that were talking broadly about science and environment. So you see here, maybe I can make this bigger. Yeah. So you have europa.eu, so you different things, but you have also personal blogs, you have a political party, for example, here, a socialist party, etc. After we text mine all the content of these blogs to extract some vocabulary which is related to health and environment. So here you have fast food, marine, you have competitivity, but you have fauna, FSDERA, which is an organization. So a lot of listing here. We have about 2,500 terms. These terms for every period of 15 days, which are here, for every period of 15 days, we mine these terms in the production of that period to look how they are connected by these blogs, and this allowed us to identify topics. So topics over, for example, that period, which is December 20 to January 20, there was a lot of topics here. And you have, for example, here, topics about Unflora and Monsanto. If I go inside, so you will see that the topic is labeled by two words, but there is more keywords inside. Here, the keywords are French agriculture français, Unflora, autorisation culture, BASF, boycott, déchets nucléaires, this is like an error of the algorithm. Nothing is perfect, but it's nice to see it. Monsanto, maïs, Greenpeace, etc. So the automatic mining of has detected these bags of words has been relevant as a topic at that period of time. You can see here the related blog post, so you can see that effectively, indeed, we are speaking about that. And here, this is the evolution in terms of philonomy and also in terms of evolution of attention of the blogosphere, of the blogosphere, attention of the blogosphere over that topic. So that topics here, actually we are in this station here, but we can go at the beginning here. So I go back in time, so now I am here. So here it was, the topic was a new MGO potatoes in Europe, question mark, and this was something about introducing these potatoes in Europe. And actually this makes some debate, and this is a debate has been identified here. And if you look at autorisation culture, mise en culture en flora, so we are talking about over a period of 3 months, 3-4 months about this, and there is some different areas of society that are speaking about that. So this is measuring here, the aid is more or less proportional to the number of posts about that topic in the blogosphere. And the different streams are the proportion of actors of a given category which is involved in that debate. So because when we bought this raw data from this companies with the raw data, they have some manually tagging all the blogs, saying that this is a blog from less party, this is a blog about science, this is a blog. Okay. So we know this kind of ontology, so we can see that, for example, this big stream here, this is traditional media, so Le Monde, Figaro, etc. But after you have institutional, you have extreme right, etc. So you can see how different people are involved. But so what you have to keep in mind is that what we put to the system is this is here is 200,000 blog posts from about 2,000 websites. We give it to do some text mining, give to me, we give to us some list of terms. So we have checked the list of terms because these are never 100% accurate. And when we validate the list of terms, we send it back to the machine. And as the output, you say, okay, over that, this and this and this and these topics, and for every topic, this is the history. And when you go to the homepage, these blue waves are all the topics which have been active over these 6 years, all identified by the algorithm. We have missing lots. But you have, this is the topic that we have just saw, Commission OPM. So it was about the interference between European law and French law, so about GMO, but there was another one about Sarkozy and Madame Reding. So there was like debate about the Rome, so it's on the same screen. And you have the summary here also, you can enter with just textual. You have potentially emergent stream, which are the ones that are just having two operations to show up during that period. And you have suspended streams, which are the ones that are not more active at the time where you look at you open your interface. So this gives you like really like overview of what you have, and you can go down back to the document. And this is really not a tool that tells you exactly how you should think about things. It's more like a heuristic. It helps you to make some category of documents, show you how they transfer in streams, And since you can go until the documents and you make your mind, saying, okay, this string is more positive, negative, or something like that. And just to end, I will show you one that I really like, which is mediator. I think that we have spoken about. So here he's saying that it's beginning on September 29th, and with valvulopathy, atteint of our liver cardiac, with maximum of popularity for retirer du marché et coupe fin, because it was used as a breaker. And here you have mediators, and we were exactly in the time window where this starts. So you see how a scandal like this starts. Only one post by the Telegram here in September, nothing, a leak from the National Health Insurance, Caisse d'Assurance Maladie. There was a report that leaked at that time, so it makes some attention, and then nothing. And then there was a publication of that report, and then the scandal begins. And you can follow the scandals and see the ramification. So we can do exactly the same thing with science, and here with science, it will be scientific tools instead of debates. And the idea is that with these kind of tools, we can map the relation of science and go back to the document, and after we'll make you one idea.
Okay, thanks. That was very useful, because this is something that we could, you know, sort of take over without too much adaptation. But okay, I go back and open the floor for questions and comments.
Yes. You have explored those data by a descriptive way. And also,
I forgot to set them on my mind. Could you please introduce yourself?
Yes.
It would be very helpful if you just stated which discipline you come from.
Okay, so I am in a computer science field. I have a background in science applied to computer and general science, like thermodynamics and so on. So I run a company that is very central Europe, and it's a software engineering and so on. I was in the past interested in automatic summarizing data. That's why I am wondering why have you found some correlation, some new relation between data? Because here you work on experimental text. It's a publication, of course, but all the authors have not the same level, and have you found something new in the relation between the data or categories you have worked with? Because there are I see that it's more descriptive, like a statistical description. And also, there are more trans parameters. There are trans and descriptive. It's my vision. Maybe I am wrong.
So, for that part about text mining.
Yes.
So for that part of text mining here, what I show is mainly what we can call reconstruction. Is so you extract pattern, you try to extract higher level structures that help you to after ask questions to your corpora. So for example, one thing that we look at is there some regularity in the evolution of science? Is there some regularity in these kind of shapes? Our first question was more in the side of the epistemology, not knowledge discovery. More like, can we say that there are some regularity in the way that things evolve and expand, and we find some interesting things. For the knowledge discovery stuff, so we when you do that, when you want to find new relations, generally you have an idea in mind. For example, if you want to find new gene relations, So there are some teams at the competitive institutes that we are working on that and very successfully using tools that are close to that. For example, there is one platform which is called Linkerbrain, which will be public, made public quite soon, where you can say mine the literature and you ask some questions. For example, you want to know the relation between violence and empathy, and it mines the literature, look at all the fMRI results and all the about this literature, and can show you in the brain which are the most probable area which are activated about these two terms, what are their connection, and after you can interpret it more if you have some skills in neurology. This same group of people, they find some only by text mining. So they take a bunch of terms describing emotions and also some action verbs like seeing, grasping, etc. And by only doing some text mining and looking at the results in the map, which is both when you show the relation between the terms, they extract a functional structure of the brain and showed that, say, most probably, and I think that has been confirmed later, but this has to be checked, but that there are some structural and functional structure in the brain connecting the different area of the brain, which are analogous to what you see in the map, semantic map, which I think was very impressive, because you can only by analysis literature infer that there is some functional structure and some functional connection in the brain. So it's like two brains that are working more or less independently. And so this is what they found. I don't know I think it has been corroborated by actual fMRI. I'm not sure. If not, and if it's false, it's not the question.
You've touched upon an area where I do research. This is still an open question. The confirmations that have come on the structure of the brain, etc., but we discussed this at dinner, do not coincide as well as was expected from the computational simulations as they developed. This is still a very gray area. I take it with a big grain of salt, if I may be honest. This is my view of it. And, you know, being a cognitive linguist and doing research in labs with neuroscientists, that you always have two bunches, the guys who do this computational stuff and love it, and the people who actually do the fMRIs and dissect brains and all that, you know, gruesome stuff, but I still believe in the gruesome stuff. So this is my sort of view of it. But to be very honest, because I know that everybody does not do this here, there are correlations. I would never say don't do simulations. They help what they do. I'm going to try to formulate this as best I can. What they do is they pose questions that then can be,
yeah, exactly.
This is their main contribution.
This is heuristic.
Yes, it doesn't even matter if they're right or wrong, whatever,
yeah.
You know, but it's the contemplation of certain functions of the various structural parts of the brain. This is something, you know, that. So I see it that way, but this is my opinion. Okay, who's next?
I will try to be shorter.
I'm sorry, but I had to intervene. Marike, Sean, did you put up your hand? Yes, somebody else? Yes.
Thank you very much. That was a terrifically stimulating presentation. And I'm Sean Ryder, and I'm a literary critic and historian, so I'm a hardcore humanities person. And like Milena, I'm very interested in how the model here, I suppose, provokes us in the humanities into thinking about how we validate research and how we, the processes by which we also publish and seek for truth, if you like, in some way. I think that what's interesting to me is this concept of refutation, because I think that means something quite different in the sciences compared to the humanities. I think it's a concept which is a more difficult for us in the humanities to use with any kind of certainty or with any strength in a certain way, because so much of what we do, I mean, there are occasions where I suppose new research in humanities can be based on sometimes the discovery of new data. You may find some new text or some new information. Sometimes it's based on revisiting old data in a new way. And very often it's about revisiting old interpretations of data. And in that area, it's very difficult to use that concept of refutation, because the older knowledge and the older data is still meaningful in some way. So perhaps there's not that same kind of rhythm of information or research being, if you like, refuted and then discarded or become redundant in some way. Very often we return to the research of the past precisely precisely because it is a research object for us. We want to re-examine that knowledge and consider it in relation to our present paradigms. I think, for instance, of something like feminist criticism, which caused a rethinking of the research of the past, as well as the data of the past, if you like. But it didn't necessarily mean that literary critics and historians weren't looking at that data of the past or at that research of the past. In fact, what happened as a result of a new innovation in terms of the framework or paradigm was that a new dynamic or relationship between the scholarship of the past or the research of the past and the research of the present became interesting. So that you're, even back to the example of Newton, I think from a humanities perspective, you could be very interested in Newton's theories now because you want to historicize them, you want to understand, you know, you're not thinking of the theories as being somehow invalid, but you're thinking about why did these theories arise at that time? And that becomes a powerful research question. And so generating knowledge from those, you feel like, valid theories is still knowledge for us, it's still valuable. So I just think it's very interesting because it does pose a question to us in the humanities about how we do innovate, what makes new research, what makes innovation, how do we use this concept of reputation, if we use it at all. So thank you, it's a very interesting learning presentation.
No, I'm not sure whether it was my anything or the gentleman behind Sean. No, no, okay. Guess come first, right? Organizes last.
Yes, I have a computational linguistics. So I repeat it again, it was very interesting, I liked it very much. So the main thing I think was that if we want to do like experimental methodology and so on, we need incentives to refute theories or to work on existing theories that have been published before and so on. Have you looked at, so as far as I know, there are a couple of fields that do that, like having special tracks in conferences and things. So have you looked at these fields and by tomorrow?
No, not yet. Okay. There are many things that I have not done.
Okay. But you have to do it.
But it's so good for you.
Thank you. I'm Lambert. I'm from TIB Hannover, that's a library. And yes, thank you. It's very interesting, really. And I want to ask a question that may sound a bit odd. How do we know if and when a paper is refuted? To me, it's not that easy, because in most cases, bibliometrics only counts how and when and by whom and referred to, but not what is the content, what is the intent of this reference. And maybe in addition to that question, there are some approaches like what Peter Murray Rust is doing with content mining in articles, where he tries to isolate facts and statements from papers. And I guess this is for some science fields like chemistry very worthwhile, very interesting. And I ask myself if it could be worthwhile or thinkable to do something similar with the semantics of references, because most often you don't have a typology, or it's not actively used by scientists, a typology of references. Yes, I base my work on that paper, or I refute it, or but maybe with methods like sentiment analysis, we could do that. But what was your impression? This is an interesting question.
So for the status of refutation, whatever the field, I think that it's still quite rare that a paper is refuted in itself. So we have some examples that are well known, so that people have manipulated data, but it's like a minor thing. Among the big sea of potential paper that could have flaws, but sometimes it's not so important that it has flaws in it. Most important that it is has provoked a new research to somebody that wrote something better. So, but still, we are seeking since a lot of times to how we can categorize a citation and to say if this the author is building on this citation or on the contrary. Unfortunately, up to now, we did not have either time or skills to do this properly, so we have not go to that direction. But this was in mind. I remember that maybe 6 years ago, we proposed a Huber project on that, and it wasn't accepted. Maybe that's why we go to another way. Anyway, I think this is a really interesting question.
Yeah, but that was too early.
Too early, I agree completely.
No, but
try it again.
Yeah. But this is really, I think that now with the technology in linguistics, we begin to be able to say, okay, this is more or less, even if it's a beginning, because sentiment analysis, I think, is not quite mature, but we are going to that direction. And I think that in 5 years, we'll be able to do this quite properly. And if I might like to add something, there is another thing that I'm working on, which goes that direction is, for example, there is some marker that gives you some indication about the reliability of your paper. For example, in biomedical literature, you have mention of p-value.
Mention
of p-value about your results. So it's really a confidence on the results.
Yeah.
So now we are publishing, we have submitted the paper in the review, but we have mined all the p-value from all the mainline literature since 25 years and look at its evolution and how it, and it's very interesting because, and we have compared full text and abstracts, and you see how p-value are used to push the paper and to there is a strong bias into the presentation of results towards presenting good p-value compared to what you have in the full text paper. So this is first things. So you can quantitatively measure it. And you can also see that through time, the mean average value of p-value is getting higher. But still it's different across category of journal. So high ranking journal are generally much lower p-value than low ranking journal. You can observe this. And also you have another phenomena, which is p-value hack, which are people that still try to present results that are not significant. And this also is increasing. So there is a lot of nice analysis here to try to infer the quality of the paper and the evolution.
Okay, Nico.
Thank you. Mikko Tolonen from the University of Helsinki. This is slightly boring because I'm going to keep on the same line as all the other hardcore humanists, which I also like to do intellectual history. But about your model here, is there, if you put the same picture, sorry. So is there a chance, I mean, this tree-like model that is advancing like a tidal wave, is there a possibility for gaps here? I mean, something that was thought to be refuted. Because, I mean, in the humanities, we think about maybe, I mean, the way that if we, in history, we still write monographs, style has much to do with it when we're writing. And so it's a sort of, we're talking about like fashions.
Yeah.
Fashions come and go. And intellectual history, for example, Arthur Lovejoy's idea of unit ideas was severely refuted in the earlier by Quentin Skinner. Now, when we're trying to think, I mean, how concepts involved, not just not looking at words, but concepts and ideas. It might be, it looks like that that theory is coming back in a way that it was thought that it was dead completely. But now, but I'm just wondering that, is this, I mean,
except here, no, this is, but for example, here, which is on blocks, there is something coming here and it disappears. Nobody speaks about that and it's come back here.
Right.
So you have the same phenomenon in science, and you can observe this. And you can even make a typology of which kind of science is doing this.
So could you think that then the ones that we thought that were refuted, they just become latent in a way? That
you
don't have to think whether they are actually encouraged in it fully or not. So.
For example, also, it's interesting to look at, but there is an example like, for example, artificial intelligence in the 80s, there was a huge hope, and then it was like the same disappointing, but now it's coming back because with the huge statistics and all these things. So you can see this kind of evolution, and also you can see evolution which are nothing to do with the evolution of technology, just that phase fashion. One example is, for example, I think you can observe this with sociology of town, which was buried by Durkheim, but now he's coming back.
Thank you.
Okay, now it's going to be said that I have discriminated against the organizers. So, Marieke, please ask your question before we close.
Because I think you've got, well, thank you for the stimulating, very interesting presentation of the paper. And I think we've got a lot of things to discuss over dinner, and I can smell the barbecue already. So, I think we can close here, and because all I wanted to say is, as been said already, I also wanted to come back to the philosophical model behind theory, and that you, and thanking you actually for challenging my motto of the conference, which was that me excited again, openness, collaboration, diversity, collegiality, and connectedness. So this is very challenged now, and I hope you come back to my motto rather now when we go to the sausages, there is enough for everybody, so please don't fight, and start tomorrow at 9 o'clock, even though we won't have your presentation, and because we have to organize the conversation tables, and we need a little bit more time for that, so please be there at 9 o'clock, and thank you, both of you, again, and so we keep on talking to you. Thank you.